I'm Keith Yamashita. For those of you who weren't here, well, actually, I'm always Keith Yamashita, so it's not just yesterday. Let's do a quick poll, actually. If I were to divide you into three groups, those of you who consider yourselves experts at social media, those of you who consider yourselves as doing a pretty good job, and those of you who consider yourselves just starting out, could you stand up if you think you're an expert in social media? Okay, one, good, others, what, well, no, panel? You better be experts, panel, because otherwise we're going to have a short conversation. How many of you think you're pretty good at social media? Okay, we're not having the kiwi shyness thing, are we? Okay, thank you, be seated. How many of you think that you then are just starting out? Okay. Perfect. This tells us up here how we need to calibrate this. So experts chime in. Let's just start very quickly by summing up in one sentence your advice about social media. So let's just start with getting advice on the table. And Ken, I'm going to start with you because what I took away from your talk was it's not social media, it's social business.
Yep.
Anything you want to add to that? If you want to say one chunk of advice.
Don't be afraid of it. You can't avoid it, embrace it. So I think that's kind of from an attitude perspective.
Awesome.
All brands need to remember that.
Trey, please.
Yes, to use a Chinese proverb, the tea leaves are clear. Everything is going in one direction. Social media is the clear and present future of all of us. So it's time to get on.
This is Trey, who has 12 million followers on the internet. So this is someone who's lined up his tea leaves well. Aura, certainly in retail, Best Buy actually has quite a number of leading practices. What's your one sentence of advice?
My one sentence of advice would be picking up on Dave's talk earlier today. If you're shy about it, give yourself some very strong constraints for your traditional marketing channels, so you would then become creative and innovative in what you can do through social media.
Interesting.
Because I think there's a tendency to pause.
To kind of lurch forward. Mm-hmm. So those of you who are lurchers, who are beginners, don't lurch. We can go forward. Please, Derek, please.
I think those are all great. Whenever I'm trying to sell anything that's kind of new or the future, I think at the highest level of the organization, having a vision of what the role of this is going to play is critical, because everything else otherwise just becomes tactical. And I think that's when people like me and Ken get very frustrated, when brands want to do things tactically without any real understanding of what it means for the business.
So let's key off that one in a moment here. So one interesting dynamic is you have digital natives who grew up with the internet and tools, and we'll just, for the sense of purpose, call those people geeks. Then you have CEOs and many leaders who this is really foreign language, and for the purposes of our talk today, let's just call them geezers. Okay, so the geeks and geezers dilemma. What do we do to help the geezers get this?
You're asking me?
Sure.
Well, at the moment, outside of digital
and social
media.
Pick your favorite geezer. Who is that?
Ooh, that's a bit too hard. I haven't answered the question, though, which is, I think this applies to all sorts of things, but I think intergenerational kind of mentoring at the moment is very interesting, both from a purposeful business kind of perspective in terms of what Warby Parker was talking about, but from a digital and a native kind of understanding. So I think that leadership of companies should be surrounding themselves by very young people consistently, not just about digital or social media, but everything. And there are some organizations that are starting to do that really well, but I think every organization could do it way better.
So this kind of notion of reverse mentoring,
exactly.
So that the geeks help the geezers.
Exactly.
Give me an example of a company you've worked with that you think really gets that.
I haven't seen any
of them.
You
won't name the geezer, but we can Google
no.
that, so please.
But I think, I work a lot with the CEO of Unilever,
yes.
And he has created a lot of youth input into his business. I know David Jones from Havas, which is a big media agency, and he has a youth advisory board for his agency, and all the people are like 24 or 5, and I think that those are some pretty good examples.
Good. Ken, follow up a little bit on that about millennials or even younger digital natives. What are some surprising things you've learned from digital natives about how to think about this that you think, wow, I wish that CMO could really harness this?
Well, I think, again, to be very honest, when social media first started, I wouldn't call myself as the first wave of believers myself. Maybe I was just too old for that time. And what I found was, I think that these young people, they just feel so natural about it. And I think it's they don't view this as a new thing that they have to learn, or I have to change my behaviors around it. But I think this they just feel like, you know, this is how it should be for consumers to experience interaction. You know, so.
Trey, give me a little bit your personal story. So I know you've actually been a coder a really long time, but actually in terms of your 12 million following, that's happened over the last 5 or 6 years. Give me your, how do you go from zero to 12 million followers? What's the secret of that?
Well, I think it probably does fit within the context of the overall conference, and it's to be disruptive, not disruptive for the sake of disruption, but disruptive for the sake of being interesting. Grabbing hold of something that you feel is cool and interesting and just really massaging it and making it feel bigger than life and change people's lives, make the conversation more than just about you, create something else, you know, bigger than you or bigger than the brand. It's like, you know, when you have a dinner party and if you're the host or the hostess of the dinner party, you know, you go around and make sure everyone's happy, right? But you know it's a successful dinner party when everyone is already talking amongst themselves. So once you make it more than about yourself, about a movement or just something awesome that people want to be part of that's life-changing or life-affirming, then things really take off.
So one thing is we're all thinking about how to harness social media. What is it that, what knowledge do we offer up? What story do we offer up? What conversation's already out there and how we might coalesce it and get it started? What story might start out there that we want to magnify? So think about your own business and think about what your answers might be to those questions as we go to Aura, who will tell us about Best Buy, because I know there's just, give us, paint a couple pictures here.
Well, there are, I think, many aspects or several aspects to social media at Best Buy, and I think they range from being quite innovative to perhaps still being a little behind the curve. And starting from the behind the curve would be a reliance on more traditional advertising channels that are product-based. And that has to do a lot with a very deep relationship with vendors, where the vendors are at, and how that's kind of self-perpetuating. The example that I'd rather talk about would be, for instance, you know, in the spirit of geeks and geezers would be, so Best Buy owns a company called Geek Squad, which is really the, obviously, the geeks in the company, but have tremendous knowledge, technological and technical knowledge. So about, I think, 2008, 2009, there was the opportunity, anybody in the company could offer up innovative ideas and get some internal funding to launch what is deemed to be a good opportunity for the company. So Geek Squad was already embracing social media at that point to sort of share their knowledge. It started out with sort of as a training tool amongst each other, and they wound up creating, and the CMO sponsored something called 12th Force, which went from an internal training tool to then leveraging social media as a way to share out knowledge, to join in forums, to help answer questions for any consumer out there, or shopper out there, related to products, services, and so forth. So that grew very rapidly, became very successful, and actually in the past year or so, we've now incorporated 12th Force with enterprise customer care, which is basically support for all customers as one common platform to really leverage social media to speed up the dialogue and enrich the dialogue with customers who need help.
So it's a real great example. Ken, you're part of it's about social business, it's not just about social media. So that example starts with social business. It's
right.
We'll do it inside the company. It isn't about crazy things you might see on Twitter or something that would happen. We start first with inside.
And a very youthful
yes.
You know, team of employees saying we there's a set of tools that we use naturally
yes.
that make sense to us,
and
we
natives.
Believe that they have right merit
yes.
for the business at large.
Trey, please, you wanted to comment on that.
No, I thought you said it in a lovely way. I have nothing to add. It was great. Yeah.
You can still comment even if it is yeah. lovely.
No, she's right on, and I love what she was doing at Best Buy with their internal initiatives and what he was saying, especially what Ken was saying about how social media is like a subtree of a subtree. It's just ridiculous.
Yes.
And if you do, you know, bring social in as a main part of the business and start to get it as part of the group think, and I think actually New Zealand is ideally placed for this, because New Zealand, I just recently moved here about a year and a half ago. I moved down to the South Island, and so this is, the differences between New Zealand and other countries is still fresh and very tangible in my mind. And the great advantage that New Zealand has, I hope you guys don't take it for granted, maybe you do, but you're just so gosh darn genuine in everything you do, you know, you're so authentic. And this is very special in the world, actually, because in the US and Europe, and I'm not so sure about Chinese markets, but nobody trusts any corporations in the US. There's the rare exception, like the Whole Foods, but that's the exception rather than the rule. If any marketing or social media stuff comes out from these big European or US corporations, people are like, this, you know, does this pass the smell test? Is this really authentic? Or did they go through a bunch of marketing committees to make this seem super authentic? It's unclear, but anything that comes out of New Zealand just has this patina of just gilded truth about it. And it's amazing. So you guys have an amazing opportunity to...
That might be the tagline for the country. Oh. The patina of gilded truth. Come to New Zealand.
Yeah, and when you're authentic, you can get away with a lot of crazy stuff, man.
Well, let's talk about authenticity. Yeah. So if many of your companies are just getting started out with social media, there's two sides to authentic, right? So one is, how do we actually show up as our best authentic self? And God forbid people don't like our best authentic self. Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about that authenticity and how, you know, so Geek Squad, you've got a whole range of people, please.
So I was gonna say, does Geek Squad seem inauthentic coming from a large corporation?
No, that seems pretty grassroots, I think, because a lot of people know the origin of Geek Squad and how it was acquired and this and that. And plus, you can get, if you just use the word geek, it gets you a little bit of street cred.
So for those of you who don't know Geek Squad, tell us a little bit more about what Geek Squad does and who they are.
Geek Squad started as, the founder was Robert Stevens, and it basically, he was an art school dropout who built a company based on tech support. So the idea that it was a squad of geeks who would drive around in Volkswagen Beetles and help repair, basically provide mobile tech support. And so Best Buy bought Geek Squad, and it's become kind of the technical foundation for customer-facing support. And also, through Geek Squad, the company offers protection, support services, in-home installation, and so forth. So it's really the services arm of Best Buy.
So think about your own companies. Where do you have expertise? Where do you have people who want to engage? Where do you have people who are customer focused? And how might you give them the tools and voice to be able to connect with the outside world?
Right.
Now tell me a little bit about each of your learning about social media. So I'll go back to you, but I'd love to hear from all of you guys in terms of, I've always considered you a brilliant designer and a great master strategist when it comes to brands and experiences. But I wouldn't say that when you went to Best Buy that you would necessarily say social media was your depth of understanding. So how did you become an expert? How did you become someone who is conversant and can direct a team and can deal with other SVPs?
So I wouldn't consider myself an expert in social media. But what I would say is that the adjacency of social media to creating the broad experience is really important. So I am conversant, and I'm curious and interested in how and where in a customer's journey does social media play a role all the way across that journey? And then how is it most, can it be most
And how did
authentic?
You come so, to your own understanding? What was that process like? Because I think all of us in the room, we're on our own journey of, well, what is that thing? What? How does that work? I don't, you know, how,
well,
what
I think
was your
you can
process?
See through the presentation yesterday, I'm kind of curious.
Yeah.
And so I'm constantly sort of scanning, not only, so I've been focused on retail for 3 years, so scanning not only within retail, but in a very broad spectrum of areas to see what are new experiences, what are new emerging behaviors, synthesizing that and kind of mapping it to the task at hand or the problem at hand, which has been retail. So social media has naturally fallen into.
On your previous domain of expertise, you just kind of keep weaving it into things that you understand. Mm-hmm. Ken, so you know, now that you lead one of the world's largest social networks, but you probably were not always that.
No.
So what was your own journey? You know, whether you go back 8 years or 9 years or 6 years, what was your own journey of learning? Because teach us, where do you look for learning?
Yeah.
Who teaches you?
I think that's a great question. You know, as I said, from not the first wave of believers myself as in social media, and then
you're a second adopter. You're not necessarily the first.
I was right behind the first one.
Yes.
But I think I actually, you know, as you were asking this question, Keith, and I was thinking, and maybe one of the things I think all of you guys should think about is this is not an entirely new thing, because I think again, if you think about what social media does for brands, when I talk about how you do branding, how you do all these things, I think a lot of fundamental truth about how brands should communicate with consumers, how you should tell stories, how you should sell your stuff, it actually didn't change. Because I still think that you know, shouldn't always be the case that brands should know what the customers want, tell them the things, why you want my stuff, you know, give you good service, and I think that fundamental truth actually is still the same, no matter what media platform was. I think what has changed is the speed of the communication, the scale of the communication, and maybe some formats of the communication. So, and I think maybe also to answer your first question is, how do we get over that fear? How do we educate other people who don't believe these things? Is actually removing some of these novelties around this and actually seeing some of the cores of the principles behind it. And I think once you get to know that, I hope that you feel more comfortable about this, because it's a new way for you to tell the story. If you have a good story, if you have a genuine, authentic story, why are you afraid of telling that story to more people in a faster way? And if you are genuine, believe your customers, why don't you want to hear from them? So, and I think, you know, maybe that will help. And that's certainly how I digest it, how I think about these things, and also try to advise brands to think that way as well.
Derek, what about you? So you're more towards geek than geezer. What's your learning been?
So
how did you become an expert in this?
I also come out as like a fraud. I'm not an expert in social media, I don't think.
Did you say you come out as a what?
A fraud. Right?
Oh, a fraud. On the stage. What a high compliment to your couchmates.
Yeah. I came at all this stuff, I think some people in New Zealand know I worked very hard at the very beginning of this decade of 2001 to help push mobile as a medium for brands. And you know, to have a vision of what is going to be important in technology in the future, I've always been interested in that. So as mobile started to collide with social, we started to really look into it. You know, early 2004-05, when you looked into Asia and you could see these social networks that don't look like Facebook, they more look like Habbo Hotel and different things like that, where you're creating almost like SimCity environments. That's when I started to really expose myself to it. And then as we continued to, you know, sell our services to people like Ken and the big agencies, they kept asking us, well, what is all this social stuff and why should we spend money on mobile versus social? And so we started to inform ourselves how these two things meet. And now we see them totally colliding and intersecting. And I have a company in Australia, New Zealand, which is a media company that sells to agencies, and we think of them as almost becoming the same thing in the next couple of years. So that's as far as professionally. But personally, I still feel that it's very difficult to keep up. And I think surrounding myself with people that are 10 years younger than me, which is getting harder and harder, you know, the early 20s, is critical. I remember last summer, US summer, going to my brother-in-law's birthday party, and he hangs out with people a lot younger than me, and no one was using Facebook. They were all using Instagram, and I wasn't even on Instagram. And these kind of epiphanies are very hard for you to experience just by reading about them on the internet. But when you see 15 kids that don't actually use Facebook, mm-hmm. you start to really question, whoa, I have no idea what's going on. And I think constantly like exposing yourself to these situations is difficult but critical, because it makes you feel a little bit
old. How old were these kids who are no longer using Facebook? I'm just curious.
Not that young. They were like 20 to 25.
And you know, I have a theory about that, because my own kids fit that category. I remember when my son went to college, Facebook was limited to college students in the United States. And so it was a closed network, and it seemed sort of an equivalent. I think LinkedIn started around the same time, so it was kind of this cool thing of like, oh, there's a social network for working folks and then for university students. And so I saw this arc over the course of the next maybe 5-6 years where they got onto Facebook, Facebook grew, everybody got on Facebook, too many people they knew got on Facebook, too much was said on Facebook, and they got off Facebook. And so I think, I wonder if it's that particular generation who really appreciated that initial exclusivity that they had, so they're seeking that exclusivity by kind of bouncing off onto the next.
Well, let's build
I'm
on
curious,
that. Yeah, let's build on that a little bit, because our firm did some work with Mark and the team at Facebook when they were about 28 million users. And the best lesson that I ever heard come out of his mouth is he said, you know, everyone's focused on social media, on the media part. Can you kind of make this assumption? And he said, what we really need to focus on is the social part, which is what holds the bonds of people together. So you think of the 4 million people in New Zealand, what are the bonds that are already there? Mm-hmm. Teach us a little bit about the human quality. So whether it's on Instagram or Facebook or your platform, what are the kind of human dynamic at play? That's always going to be at play. So that one to me is, we want to belong, but we want to belong to a small tribe, not a large tribe. And we want to choose. What are some of the other human truths that come forward? You focus on the social part of social media. What are those learnings?
Is this for me?
Any and all, or Google Glass, or whomever on the internet.
By the way, I've had a few people come up to me and say, like, is something wrong with you? No, this is called Google Glass. It's sort of a new wearable computer that I think is going to be quite popular. With social media and basic human traits, like Ken said, we've always been doing this. We've always had humans that talk to each other and share ideas and families that communicate. But social media and the internet just basically makes it more efficient by at least two orders of magnitude. And so you know what it's like if you're not connected to the internet for a while, you feel like a little, you know, like maybe some sort of an insect that's lost his antennas, or, you know, you feel like you've lost like the sixth sense that we've all gotten, this sense that there's other people out there, we're communicating with them in sort of an asynchronous way. So it's very naturally human. And I would like, rather than just speak in generalities, I'd like to give people like something actionable to do that's fairly simple and actionable. And I would strongly advise to get on Google Plus, because no one has really mentioned this, but early in January, Google Plus passed Twitter in terms of number of users. Back in May, it was 500 million. And people do compare a little bit too much to maybe Facebook or Twitter or whatever, but it's really not like that. Google Plus is Google. It's the next evolution of Google. They've realized that the internet is people, right? And so even if you don't actively use the Google Plus stream, 98% of at least the Western world, they Google search stuff, right? So if you have products or services, which most people here do, and you have a customer that jumps on Google and they say, like, tires in Auckland, right? This is a wallet out search term. They want to go buy some tires in Google, or some tires in Auckland. And so if you're on Google Plus and then you've made a little plus page for your thing and you put it on Google Maps, and then you've encouraged your customers to come give it a rating or whatever, you're going to be number one in the search results. You're going to be ahead of all the competition. And so I think you should like open up a little store on all these social networks. But I mean, Google is where it's at. And plus, as opposed to Facebook and Twitter, which have a questionable and non-existent business model, Google makes tens of billions of dollars. You don't have to worry about these guys. They're going to be around for a long time. And your customers will constantly be searching for your products and services. And soon, when people have wearable computers and stop pulling something out and typing on it, and they could just talk to it. Here's a really short story. So I was here in Auckland with my wife and three kids. And Google knows that I like sushi, because I search for sushi a lot. And so up in Glass, it just suggested 5 nearby sushi restaurants right around dinner time. And so I was looking through them, and I saw, oh, there's Sushi Train. And it just navigated me right there. It's because I've had a lot of friends that have been to Sushi Train. They like it. They've given it, you know, a plus one, or they've given a little bit of a rating. And even if I was just using my cell phone, Google now knows that it's dinner time, knows I like sushi, and it recommends products and services for me. It searches for me before I need to search for it. This is where everything is going. So anyway, get on Google Plus. Get your customers involved with that, because people are going to be searching for your stuff.
And go to Sushi Train. I'm going to open it up for questions, so think about your own questions. We're going to just take a few questions before lunch. Not many, so if you're starving, say, like, for God's sake, let's finish this panel. think about just a few, to think about a few questions. I'm gonna ask you guys one more. I was at a conference with a bunch of HR, very senior HR leaders from very established global companies, and there was, I would categorize them more in the geezer category, an HR leader who stood up and very passionately said, "This tweeter thing really has me worried." Okay. And then another one said, "Well, you know, a tweet could kill your company. A bad tweet could kill your company. It's, you know, it's
part
of the."
Can I tell you a story about that?
Yes, please. And what I want to talk about a little bit is about perceived risk versus real risk of engaging in a realm.
I think there's real risk. There's serious risk, right? Because once you tweet something, as you saw with the Tesla, it just gets out there and you can't pull it back, or with anything you put on the internet, which also applies to your own personal brand. Anything that's out there, you can't tell Google to pull off. We worked with one of the major automotive companies in America. We were doing all their vision and strategy for mobile, and so we worked with the social agency. And this agency was managing all their handles for all the different vehicles.
Handles, everyone understands handles.
Is the accounts, and you know, so they had like 15 different accounts for all the different cars. Like, it was just an army of people. But because they're all young people, because they know what they're doing, they're also proficient and prolific on their own social media activities. And so they're running an app that's doing all these different handles and their own one. And this person tweeted, this is all out on the internet, some really foul stuff about the city of Detroit and this traffic and just like full of swear words and how shit it was all on the General Motors handle.
So just a little click of the wrong tab.
So of course, I mean, it just blows up across the internet, but it's gonna happen to a lot of the brands that are running huge social media campaigns. The more important thing is, I think, how they respond. And so they responded in your traditional way, like fire the guy, blah, 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 like all the, you know, the PR team gets control of it and does what they think is the right thing to do. And I think if you're gonna be active in this space, then having a plan for how you react to really negative things is going to be critical, and doing it in a human way is really important. And when you haven't got the plan, then you'll do it in the PR way, because they'll come right from the top in terms of corporate comms and do it in the only way that they know how. So I think it's naive to think that mistakes don't happen. They do, but really great opportunity to show humanity when you respond and address them.
Yeah, so what you just said is super interesting. I see this a lot. And corporations, when they do make mistakes, and they always do, most of the US corporations, they go back, they retreat back, and they, like Nikon did something very stupid. I'm a Nikon fan or whatever, but they, on their Facebook, they said, a photographer is only as good as the equipment he uses, right? Which is this kind of incendiary statement for people, like, you better buy all our best stuff or you're not a good photographer.
Not to mention if you're a woman,
right.
Yes.
And they sort of do this ridiculous thing where they fire the guy, they pull back control, because it was just some, again, sub-context intern that put because they didn't take it seriously. And then PR takes control, and then every tweet that goes out is like decided upon by a committee. You know, that's why you never see a statue of a committee, because, they never do anything interesting. But you should be like, a Warby Parker and have fun with it. Just do a lot of crazy stuff. Some mistakes will happen, but play with the mistakes and have a good time. You know, it's a social thing.
So human error is human response. Mm-hmm. Ken, what's your summing up on real risk? And then I'm going to open it up. So think about your question, please.
I think Derek said very well. I mean, I think that it is real and it's how you respond. But I think another point is, even if you don't make those mistakes, consumers might be out there talking about your brands anyway, so you have to have a way of response. And again, be transparent and just, I think that's what brands need to do.
But it was interesting, in that exact same session I was in with the, boy, this tweeter thing has me concerned. There was another HR leader that said, all this conversation about our company has always been going on. It's been going on for 80 years. It's just it's now made visible and we have to contend with some people don't like our company or how we've employed them. He says, the better thing, our best defense, is create a great company.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I think that was such great advice.
And I just want to add on to that is one thing, again, I mentioned earlier, now your brand is co-owned by you and your consumers. Now, some of your consumers, I hope, they're actually loyal fans. They like your brand. So leverage them as well. Don't be just you be the single voice out there talking about brand. You're inviting these loyal fans, to see VIPs and things like, just like Trey was said earlier, you start off something, but you're not the only one who's keep talking to your fans, right? So if you can actually organize them and start them, and then, you know, again, so don't worry just about the negative voice, there's positive voice there as well.
Yes.
So.
Let's take one or two quick questions and then we'll go out to lunch. So please, microphone and or shout or both. Could you share your name with the audience, please?
Testing 1, 2, yes. My name is Christian Jewell. I manage the Asia Pacific Design Library in Australia. I'm curious about the relationship between the online community and the physical community. And I've got a bit of a hunch when I see successful brands and the kind of middle of the road experience that I've had, that when those kind of pop-up, meet-up, real-world flash mob things happen and the online community gets to meet in the real world, there's a bit of magic there, and I'm kind of curious, you know, what your experiences have been and whether there's a kind of strategy or thinking around that.
Who wants to field that one?
Want me to?
Sure.
I want you all to. Okay, I have a really good quick example. So I'm a photographer, artist kind of guy, and we have big photo walks whenever I go to cities. And so really, it's clear to me that so many of us spend time just alone, like in dark rooms on the internet, right? And so we do crave social interaction. And so the idea that you can get out and meet other people that share some kind of passion, in my case it's photography, then you all get together and you meet and you're kind of awkward looking at each other's cameras, and it's kind of weird because everyone's a little bit introverted and not sure about this weird social situation where people just meet en masse on the internet. But then, you know, you walk around, you take photos together. It's an amazing experience. People have a good time. We share online afterwards. And then, once again, before the event, it's this many-to-one relationship where they all know me or a brand or whatever it might be. But then at the end of the event, they all know each other, right? So, you know, I can leave, and now we've created a nice little community which will grow on its own right there. We kind of rinse and repeat this in various places. And I think it's a really cool idea for brands to do this kind of stuff because it brings people that are alone together, and it's better to be together.
Nice. Let me take one more question, and then we'll wrap this up. One last question, please. In the far, far right corner, in stripes, with the perfect microphone coming your way, and your name is?
My name's Tess. I've got a question about serendipity versus, you know, I'm out looking for sushi and it's dinner time, and so the human aspect of technology that we've heard a lot about, the serendipity versus the I know what you want before you want it and here it is. How do people feel about that?
I would say that based on Trey's example, it works both ways. That Google Plus or Google Now could anticipate that it's dinner time and that he likes sushi. If he's walking down the street with his family and they say, wouldn't it be great to have sushi for dinner tonight? How do you know where the nearest great sushi place is, or any sushi place for dinner? So it can be that it's pushed at you, and you can choose to respond or not. At the same time, you can leverage that technology to feed a need or want that you have much more quickly than otherwise.
Nice. Let's do one last concluding thing. So if we would have talked about this at the previous Better by Design, the conversation would have been one way. Today, we had this conversation about social media. The next time we convene for Better by Design, what do you think the topic in social media will be? Please, Derek.
Ooh. Well, I have a personal bias, which is kind of a little bit anti what we've been talking about, which is I think people are going to start to wonder when you know, you go into restaurants and you see a table of 20-somethings, and they're all basically interacting with their devices versus each other. When are we going to actually get to the point where the humanity is actually going to come back into the experiences that we share as people? I think the connections that social media enables are really amazing and inspiring and powerful, but there's no doubt that there's a generation being created that have forgot how to talk and interact with each other, and you can see it when they come and get jobs, and they are going to be very fast in the next 3, 4, 5 years losing a lot of human skills that, at the end of the day, if you take away the internet, they're going to be as vital now as they will be in 100 years, and I think that's something that we'll need to start facing up
to. So the return of humanity, please.
I was just going to say that's a very good point. You know, if I bring that back to a Best Buy, it's about the fact that we've got to now train young people coming in to make eye contact with customers, speak directly to them.
You have to train them to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, because especially with its interest in technology, you get the folks who,
versus,
you know.
Could you step back so I can tweet about you?
That's right, yeah. Exactly.
What's your handle?
Yeah.
So I was going to say, in terms of the next conference, I suspect that, you know, I'm also really intrigued with what Google Plus, for instance, stands for, and the idea of, or the comment I made earlier about Facebook. So the idea of niche social media and sort of multiple identities, more branded social media and so forth, like what's that going to morph into? Because I think we're cresting with some of the large players.
Nice. Trey, please.
I think that next year, the companies and brands that start seriously engaging in social media in a fun, aggressive way, you're going to have a lot more stories about mm-hmm. customer interactions. And just like Bob was talking about, he would send off that corporate, the CEO newsletter to 11,000 people, he'd get back stories. Then he would reuse those stories to motivate and inspire people. Well, you can do this on a grand scale of tens of thousands, you know, hundreds of thousands, millions of people, your customers. And if you're just cool, like, you know, Warby Parker and have fun with it, look at these, those little stories. I bet they had 100 awesome stories they could tell us. And every one of these is a nice little thing you can share with your fans and share with the public. And it's just, it makes things fun. And I think that's sort of the secret ineluctable element of all of this is that it can be a really fun layer on top of your company.
Ken, last word, please.
I have two wishes. One more conservative. I think, I will hope that brands again talk more about social business, the actual business results from doing social media. And more optimistic hope is actually sort of aligned with what you guys said. I don't feel that people need to separate out social media as a separate thing to talk about. But that's also, again, social media, I think the definition is broader than just Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. I think word of mouth is social media. And I think that, in that essence, it doesn't really matter that much what platform we're going to talk about next year, right? Whether that be Instagram or Tumblr or whatever that is. But I think that fundamental element about empowering customers, consumers, or your stakeholders, and get everybody engaging, talking, and co-creating, I think that will remain to be very critical for business. And hopefully more business are talking about that in various ways, not just in that little team of social media. So.
Perfect. So if we have it right, 18 months from now will be a fantastic conversation about the return of humanity, the role of niche and tribe, story at scale, run your business by social, but most importantly, it's just engage as human beings. And on that, let's have lunch. Thank you.